fais aussi des subscapularis at the upper part, and then at the very lower part, we see the teres major, and then also latissimus dorsi. Latissimus dorsi. So these structures form the boundaries we are seeing at this point. If we pick out these muscles in our diagram, we will pick out. This is the bone here is part of the scapula. This is a part of the scapula. That's part of the scapula. And this is the anterior surface of the scapula. This is the anterior surface. And then we're seeing the subscapularis. This is the subscapularis muscle. And at this point, we're seeing some of the muscles we already mentioned, the teres major and latissimus dorsi, at their point of insertion. At this point, we're seeing part of teres major where it inserted into the medial lip of the bicipital sulcus. Recall that we said this is the bicipital sulcus, which formed the lateral wall. So at this point, we're seeing the two lips of bicipital sulcus. This is the medial lip and this is the lateral lip. Remember that P major inserted on the medial on the lateral lip, and then teres major inserted on the medial lip. And then we are also seeing the latissimus dorsi at the floor of bicipital sulcus, and then moving posteriorly to form the posterior wall. If you recall the lady between two majors, teres major, medial lip, pectoralis major, lateral lip, latissimus dorsi lying at the floor. But at this point, we see latissimus dorsi inserting at the floor, but running to form the posterior boundary, posterior wall of the axilla. Also noted in this diagram, in our chart, is the long head of Meissner's brachii as it ran down the bicipital sulcus. So we have looked at the four walls, which are the anterior, the posterior, the medial, and the lateral. So we'll look at the base, then I will conclude the features with a view at the apex. But let's look at the base. The base actually is the lower part of axilla. The base is the lower part of the axilla, and it's the part that is made up of skin, superficial and deep fascia. And then it is reinforced by the clavipectoral fascia as the clavipectoral fascia came down as a suspensory ligament of the axilla. This is the base. That's the base. Usually have the with a lot of hairs, hair follicle. The base has skin, is made up of skin, superficial and deep fascia. Has superficial and deep fascia and reinforced by the clavipectoral fascia. So we said the base has skin, fascia, and clavipectoral fascia reinforcing it. Next, we'll look at the apex. The apex is actually the proximal part that connects the rest part of the axilla to the neck. In fact, the apex is also called the cervical axillary canal. That is, remember the neck is called the cervical region. Now, cervical axillary canal is the canal that joins the cervical region with the axillary region or the axilla. That's why this upper part of the neck is called the cervical axillary canal. So that which is the apex. Now, the diagram we have here shows clearly the apex. The apex is actually triangular in shape. So we see the structures. We see structures coming from the neck region, and then they run down through the outer part of the face rib, and they usually run deep to the clavicle, and then they access the axilla. Like in the case of the subclavian artery. Subclavian artery passed the outer border of face rib along the midpoint of the clavicle and then passed into axilla. The vein, axillary vein, will run from the axillary region and then run through deep to the clavicle, and then by the time it runs across the outer border of face rib, it will continue as the subclavian vein. So this region has three parts. That is the apex. And this apex, these regions, these parts are, we have the anterior border, we have posterior border, and we have the medial border. So the apex is triangular in shape, and has three borders. Now those borders are, one, we have the anterior border is made up of the middle third of the clavicle. It's made up of the clavicle. The medial border is made up of the first rib. And the posterior border, that's the scapula. It's made up of the posterior border, it's made up of the scapula. So this is the scapula, the upper border of scapula, forming the posterior border of the apex. And this is the clavicle, already labeled. That's the clavicle, already labeled, forming the anterior border of the apex. And then that's the first rib. Forming the medial border. So we will now look at the content of the axilla. Now, in considering the content of the axilla, we'll outline the following. We have axillary artery and branches. Axillary artery and branches. We also have axillary vein and tributaries. The axillary vein and the tributaries. We also have the cords of brachial plexus and the branches. We also have axillary lymph nodes. Axillary lymph nodes. We also have axillary lymph vessels and fat. We have fat. All over the places. We have the artery 1, the vein 2, the cord 3, the lymphatic nodes and the vessels and the fat. Already we've done a video on brachial plexus. These neurovascular structures, these neurovascular bundles are actually wrapped in a sheath called axillary sheath. So these neurovascular structures are all enveloped in axillary sheath. What we have here shows some of the structures. That is the axillary artery. That is the axillary vein. And then we have some of the cords of brachial plexus around the axillary artery. So this and this is the axillary sheath around the neurovascular structures. Now, we'll, in earlier videos, in blood supply to the upper limb, we've already taken care of the axillary artery and branches, and then axillary vein and tributaries. Also, in earlier videos on brachial plexus, we've also taken care of the details on brachial plexus. We'll give a little detail on the lymph on the lymph nodes of the axilla. So let's take a little look at the axillary lymph nodes. The axillary lymph nodes are about, there are many. There are many in the axillary region, within the range of 20 to 30. There are about 20 to 30 in number. They can also vary beyond this. Now, these lymph nodes are actually arranged in groups. Now, we have about 5 groups, and those groups are, one, we have the group called anterior group. We have one, the anterior group. Two, we have the posterior group. Three, we have the lateral group. Four, we have the central group. And finally, we have the apical group. And these groups are seen at various area, various parts of the axilla. We'll first see the anterior group. The anterior group is a group that is clustered around the lateral thoracic vessels. And this is found along the lower border of pectoralis minor. That is where we actually see the lateral thoracic artery. So this group drains one lymph from two major points, the breast, two, from the anterior part of the trunk, anterior part of the trunk. Usually the drainage here, the region of the trunk here, the upper part of the trunk is a part above the umbilicus. So the anterior group of lymph node dressed a part of the breast and also the anterior part of the trunk, the upper part of the anterior part of the trunk. This part is the part that is above the umbilicus. The next is the posterior group. This is also called the subscapular group. This group is found along the subscapular vessels, and this is towards the lower part of the subscapularis. This group drains the posterior part of the upper part of the trunk, and also part of the breast, basically from the axillary tail of the breast. Now, the lateral group is a group that is found along the upper border of the humerus. This group is a group that drains the entire free upper limb. The central group is a group that is found at the upper part of axilla, basically around embedded within the fat of the axilla. And then what it does is to drain the groups anterior, posterior, and lateral. It drains this group and then passes them to the apical group. The apical group is embedded in the clavipectoral fascia towards the apical part of the axilla, or towards the apex of the axilla. This group is also called the infraclavicular group. Now, that is about the content. Before we round off on our lecture in the axilla, it would also be nice to notice that because of the numerous hair follicles, we notice that in cases of infections of these hair follicles or the sebaceous gland around this area, we notice the occurrence of boils within this region, which is actually very common. The remaining aspects of the clinical anatomy as it relates to the axilla will be considered in specific areas. We hope you've had a nice time. Thank you very much.